Okay, so we continue, okay, with the lessons. Welcome to fluorescence. Ooh, what is that? Fluorescence. The easy way to describe fluorescence is to give analogy. Alright? So you remember in the past when you have your analog clock or watch, when you from the light you go to the dark, and then you can see the hands and dials on your watch, okay, then you go, oh, it's great, it's glow in the dark, it's glowing. Now what color is it?
Green.
That means you are very old, because the younger generation, they see other colors as well, blue, yellow. So those things are called phosphorescence. Phosphor, there's a chemical there, phosphor, that make it glow. So fluorescence is actually the phenomenon in physics that can be easily related to glow in the dark. But there's something special about fluorescence. Any material is able to fluoresce, just in the case of whether it can fluoresce for a short period of time or for a long period of time. In the case of phosphorescence on your old watch, that is the long term, right? So the molecule of the fluorescence, the pigments, any pigments, for example the phosphor chemical, it can absorb energy from the light. So the light coming to the phosphor chemical, and then this phosphor chemical got chromophore. Chromophore is the pigment that gives it the color. It will absorb and it will excite the electron in the chemical bonds. These will cause the electron to become excited and then immediately return to the ground state. Almost immediately. When this happens, this is fluorescence. But in the case of phosphorescence in your old clock or watch, the excitation happens, but the release, the coming back to the ground, happens at a much delayed reaction time. So that's why even after 1 hour, 3 hours, you can still see the glow in the dark, right? So for the plants, it's happening as well, because plants got pigments. So anywhere you got pigments, yeah, some amount of fluorescence is happening. So the question now is whether it can glow for longer or shorter period of time. Fluorescence in plant, I think it's good to be depicted in this way. So you have your sun here. The sun is, it's a light from heaven, full cosmic spectrum radiation. Then there is a power in the cosmic radiation from the sun. What is power? Photosynthetic active radiation, meaning that we specifically referring to the nanometer 400 to 700 only, the rainbow color. Right, and this light comes to the leaf, and it's good to know the epidermal of the leaf is actually transparent, right? It's actually transparent. That's why the light can pass through the leaf and in fact get transmitted to the other side, because epidermal cells are transparent. It is not like our epidermal cell. Our epidermal cell pretty much dead. Okay, that's why you are impermeable to water. It's waterproof, your skin waterproof. Otherwise, if you go to Langkawi and swim, you're going to turn into a turtle and it's ballooning up. Yeah. Your skin got epidermal too, but it's dead. Cutant. Okay. But epidermal for the plants is actually it's alive and it's impregnated with wax, much of the species. So the light gets in, and when the light hit all the chloroplast in there, the chloroplast, then you got the chlorophyll absorb all this energy and become excited. This excited moment is the beginning of the story. what will happen to it? You see, this is your chlorophyll in the ground state. There is no star to it. The moment it absorbs the light, the chlorophyll becomes excited. Now this excited or ejected electron from the chlorophyll, it has multiple fates or destiny. Where should I go? Should I just return straight to the ground state of my chlorophyll home? Or should I proceed to do photochemistry? Should I release myself as a heat? Or should I just fluoresce, glow in the dark? Or maybe, should I wreak some havoc, turn some chlorophyll molecule into reactive species? So these are the five fates, what will happen to the excited chlorophyll molecule. Okay, so this is a better depiction of it, what I've just said just now. So you have your light coming, absorption. Understand this, okay? Just because the light has been absorbed by the chloroplast doesn't mean it has been utilized to do photochemistry and by extension photosynthesis as a whole. All right, it's very important. There are many plants are able to capture light photons, but they are not able to utilize it because maybe the proteins is insufficient, or maybe it has been sprayed with some kind of weedicide that cut the electron flow. It can absorb, but since the, you know, like what's the name, DCMU, the name of the herbicide active component, it cuts the electron transport change, then the absorbed energy can't be utilized for photochemistry, right? Okay, then what will happen to the light? Some will be absorbed, some will be reflected, some will fluoresce, some will be transferred, dissipated as heat or transmitted. We are interested today to look at this, the one that glows in the dark. Why? Because it can tell you so much about the health level of the leaf, the physiology of the leaf. Remember the photo earlier? The photosynthesis were earlier. Photosynthesis. This divide into two, right? When you use the gas exchange mode using this instrument, you are answering this side of the story. But when you turn the mode into fluorescence mode, you are answering this side of the story. Complete story. Right? So this is Kelvin cycle again. This is the photosystem health. So in essence, if your plant is fluorescing a lot, that's actually not a good thing because the light is not utilized. Okay, it's pretty much like you are so full from your lunch earlier. What did you have? Nasi biryani. And suddenly your friends trying hard to look so good to you, buy you some more Happy Meal 3 bags, then shove down your throat. What's gonna happen to you? You're gonna vomit, puking it out all outright. So that's what happened with the leaf. It can't handle, it vomits the light energy in the form of glowing. Yeah. This is, you know, if you get into my head, there's so many weird story in here. I've been, because when it comes to fluorescent especially, I've been teaching fluorescent for quite some time, like I think 7 years now. Up to this point, there's hardly, even my student, people can't really process the story. Because it's physics, it's physics. So if you have a hard time to picture the fluorescence, just thinking of you are full, then Happy Meal coming towards you, 3 bags. Can you digest the Happy Meal now? No, you're gonna vomit out. Yeah, the vomit is the fluorescence. But we are photonic vomit. Right, so thylakoid, and this is the zoom towards all the way to the thylakoid membrane. So that's a concept I would like you to learn here. right? So the concept of reaction center open and closed. If you recall from this earlier, the special chlorophyll A molecule, the P680, that is having another synonym to it. It's called reaction center. So it's all the same. P680 is equals to reaction center equals to special chlorophyll A molecule. Synonym, all the same. Okay, so you have your light photon. It is not necessary from the sunlight, okay? Any light. The light will come in and hitting your islands of pigments here. And then even though they are green, they can be other chlorophyll, not reaction center, okay? Because plant got two chlorophyll, chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B. And these are very likely chlorophyll B. Passing from one another like a ping pong until they reach the 680 and then they got ejected. And that's when the destiny will be chosen. Destiny earlier that you saw earlier. If the destiny is photochemistry, then you will follow this regular electron transport pathway. That's the regular one that you have learned earlier today. Right, but what if it follows other routes? Yeah. Okay, look at here. You got your chlorophyll, become excited, go up. These are the fates of the excited chlorophyll. It can either go in the form of fluorescence, KF, K is just for the constant. It can undergo internal conversion, the energy, just transfer to other membrane, to the next membrane. Or it can do intersystem crossing, meaning that it cross to other chlorophyll and turn the chlorophyll instable. You see, chlorophyll in plant can become mutant as well. Reactive species, right? And that is denoted by this. You see, chlorophyll 3. And there's a star there. That is actually not stable, because if you learn and remember from your electron lesson during your early science journey, do you remember electron valence? That's the outermost shell of your electron configuration, right? Usually what number that the atom like to have on the outermost shell? Duet or octet, either 2 or 8. It doesn't like other numbers. When it is having other numbers, that's why you are having plus 3, meaning that it's giving up 3 or it's receiving 3. Right. So in the case of chlorophyll, when 3 is actually not stable, that one extra will definitely become reactive species and start stealing electron from surrounding molecule to stabilize itself, right? Okay, yeah, right. So what we want to see here is here. What is other possible destiny of excited electron? Surely photochemistry. When this happened, that's fine. You got your regular photosynthesis or non-photochemical quenching. This is the release in the form of excess energy dissipation. It's heat. Okay, NPQ stands for non-photochemical quenching. So quickly now, so you have understood this. Having lots of fluorescence, is it good or not? Why not good? Yeah, so when you have lots of fluorescence going on, definitely photochemistry is not happening that good, okay? And from this measure, you can understand whether the plant is stressed or not. It's a measure of plant stress, right? Okay, so this is the concept of reaction center. open and close. So you can see here, when the plant has been completely relaxed, for example, when they have undergone a complete long, dark and cold night, direction center are said to be open. Okay, meaning that they are ready to accept any light coming to them to capture. Okay, and in this case, the moment there is a flash of light, all will be directed to photochemistry and there's almost zero fluorescence. Okay, this actually almost never happened, but it theoretically, especially for the isolated chlorophyll, this can happen. Right. And the second concept is reaction center closed, meaning that the plant is actively photosynthesizing under the sun, or it has been given saturating light for quite some time. The reaction center are going to close, and when there's a flash of light coming, surely that light cannot be utilized at all. It will be given off as fluorescence, completely vomit out. This, you eat all your food after you have been fasting for 13 hours. This, you eat your food after you having already having your nasi biryani. Which one vomit? Left or right?
Right.
Right. The right is going to do the photon vomit. Right. So I just put it here. I found it, it's interesting actually. I found it. This is actually from the wheat science paper actually. So they got three labels here. Open reaction center, closed reaction center due to the saturating light, and reaction center closed by inhibitor. This is with the herbicide. Herbicide. Some herbicide mode of action is by interfering with the reaction center ability to capture the light energy. Okay, right. So let's go down here. So what should we do with this kind of information? If you do not want your plants to fluoresce, what do you want the plants to do? Photochemistry. Yeah, actually some amount of fluorescence will happen regardless of species or the geographic location of the plants, localization, provenance of the plant. Usually the efficiency of light capture is about 0.87 to 0.85 light captured, and about 15% fluoresce, because this, we are talking about biological system, and biological system is not perfect. Okay, there's always some kind of energy waste somehow, right? Okay, so how to do the fluorescence measurement with this equipment? So this equipment actually, if you open it, if you look under it, no need, I've turned it down this way for you. There are a number of lights in here. Okay, so you got your blue light, red light, modulating light, and far red light. Actinic means any light that can trigger photosynthesis or photochemistry. Right, because there are blue light that is not actinic. Okay, because blue got many shades, and not all blue actually triggering photosynthesis. And then there are red, and this is the wavelength for the blue, 475 nanometer. For the red, 625 nanometers. You can see here, and we got the red modulating. And this is actually to give the, you can control the frequency, the hertz. And this is what we use for the fluorescence later. And finally is the far red, okay? Steady state and the dark pulse. Okay, this is a special experiment that we can do with this instrument. However, we're not going to cover this this is a special topic. Maybe you come again the training next year when I do special fluorescence. Yes. Same wavelength. Sebab because the rate modulating ni, you can control the hertz. 1 hertz to 20, 50 hertz. However, the maximum intensity only 100 micromole. This red actinic regular, you can control the intensity up to 16,000. Right. So, two different kind of red actinic. One is for saturating. One is to trigger fluorescence minimally. Okay. So this is the light that trigger fluorescence, meaning that the light energy is given to the leaf. That's why we need to modulate it, because we don't want too much. So the leaf will give just enough fluorescence signals so that it can be red. If we give a lot, other thing will happen, other destiny will happen as well. You will get heat dissipation, you will get chlorophyll excitation, and you will get many other things. But since we only want to trigger the fluorescence, this KF, that's the reason LiCOR LI use this modulating red. Okay, get it? Right. Okay. So about this red, where is it exactly? 625. It's actually just here. It's red, but not very red. Compared to 680 nanometer, this is red as well, but dark red. 625 nanometer, red as well, but lighter red. So different shades of red. Right. Okay. Ooh, what's that? So later, tomorrow, when you look at the instrument, this is the screenshot of the interface on the console here. When we do the fluorescence experiment, we are utilizing all the lights available in this instrument. And we measure this F, the fluorescence signal here. Yeah. You can see that fluorescence signal do not have unit. It is dimensionless because it's purely signal, because the machine knows how many units it gives, and then it measures back how many units are vomited out. That's why no units. Okay? Right. So let's start here. When it's completely dark, meaning that all of this light are turned off, even the modulating light, no light at all, zero. The signal is zero, nothing, okay? And then you turn on the measuring beam. Measuring beam is the synonym for red modulating. It's the same thing. Why is it called measuring beam? Because, again, the light is enough to trigger fluorescence, but the energy is not enough to trigger photochemistry. That's why you control, you modulate the hertz of the light. So when this happens, you see this region here? Yeah. This is what we call as F naught, minimal fluorescence signals. So for this plant, it's about 540. Okay. Other light, you still have not turned it. So we let it to stabilize for a while. How do we know it has been stabilized? Look at the DFDT here. This DFDT, later when you look at the screen, it's going to move like crazy. Sometimes 100, sometimes minus 20, sometimes 26. As long as DFDT has touched zero for even once, meaning that the fluorescence signal has stabilized, right? And when your plant is in this condition, this is said to be open reaction center. Okay, open meaning that now we can give the plants all it can deal with, see how much it can deal with. So this is when we give the flash here. Flash coming from who? The red actinic here, the second light here. It gives, usually we give between 10,000 micromole to 16,000. Not for too long, it's just a flash. It's just a flash, right? So you get a peak there, and this is what we call as maximum fluorescence, right? So you got this data, F naught, F steady minimal, and F max. You can start calculating fluorescence parameters for your plant. We'll see later how it is calculated. Okay, and then the moment then it goes down, you turn on the regular actinic. The regular actinic is again the flash, but at much reasonable intensity. If your plant is okay with the intensity of 1000, this is the light that you set. So you let your plant to photosynthesize as usual and happy. Right. And then after a while, maybe a minute or so, actually it should take a bit longer, about at least 10 minutes. When the plant is regularly dealing with continuous light, you suddenly give another flash, the second flash here. See, another flash. The first flash, the plant from complete darkness, meaning that the reaction center completely open. It's been relaxed. The second flash, when the plants having open and closed reaction center, both at present at the same time, meaning that steady state, right? The reaction center is not going to close and open forever. So during the photosynthesizing, let's say that 11 a.m. in the morning, it's going to close, it's going to open. So we want to see when you are happy doing your photosynthesizing work, can you deal with sudden burst of energy? Because if the plants is not having a good photoprotective mechanism, yeah, this is going is where you can see that it's completely struggling, right? So we give the second flash here, right? And then we can let the plants to photosynthesize as usual again, and then comes the dark part. Okay, this actually I'm not going to go so much. Dark part is longer wavelength. This wavelength far red here used to flush the electron from electron transport chain. You see, electron transport chain is here, right? When you use the dark pulse, it's going to activate just this region. When you give dark pulse, electrons in here, if any, you know, stuck electrons somewhere, will be flushed out. And once you have done it, you give flash, and then you can give that pass again for how many times that you want. Okay, so can you follow, or do you want the analogy time now? analogy. Okay. This region is you baru masuk kerja pukul 8 pagi. Right. Pukul berapa masuk kerja? Pukul 6. Tukit apa? Jaga. So, this is you just enter at 8 a.m. Look happy. Right. Senyum. The makeup still there. Kan? Tudung tak sengit. You know. The skirt still keras lagi. you know, all the shit, everything perfect. Everything perfect. And suddenly your KJ come. Your KJ come, when you are in this state, pukul 8 tu, it comes and they dump to your desk 100 file. Since you are still happy, you can, I can do this. You manage to deal with 80 files. 20 je tak boleh, itu pun sebab dia tulis bahasa Jepun. The rest of it you deal with. Because you just started work. You, before this, you just came from home, you have had a deep sleep, night, good rest and everything. It's good. So, this is what happening here when your KJ decide to dump you with 100 files. This is the 100 files. And then you return back. And then, of course, over the time, you are going to do your job as usual, because you can deal with your 80 files. And then throughout the days, as you finish, your KJ dump again. Your file empty, your KJ top in. Your file tak settle lagi, dia tambah lagi. And then you suddenly, APC? PCI? Apa? Yang pekerja semalam tu? APC. APC coming soon. APC coming soon. APC coming soon. I need to finish it. So, the job from your desk, in and out continuously for another few hours. However, suddenly, this is already, this is 8 a.m. This is already 3. Do you think you can keep up with the space? No. If suddenly your KJ dump another file, you're going to dump back at her. If it's her, because we are her. If you are him, you dump back at him. Because what? Because you have had it enough. Right. There's only 2 hours left before you need to go back home. Stop dumping me with jobs. Right. So that's the sign of a stress worker. But what if during 3 p.m. your KJ comes in your room, you thought she's going to dump you with all the files, right? Say, jom pergi mamak, ngetih. So she brought you to the mamak to mengetih, and then having all the mengetih, sembang-sembang, chilling, isap shisha and everything. Then browse through, ada pula tudung kat tepi tu. Pergi benda semua. Now you are relaxed, right? Now you are relaxed. Then dah sampai balik office, baru dia dump. Without all this chilling period of half an hour, if she dumped to you, you're going to throw back everything at her. Now that you have had the chilling for 30 minutes, are you going to deal with better or not? Yeah, not as good as this morning, but since you have been given a respite, a chilling period, now you can deal a bit more. So that's equivalent to this. You give the flesh when photosynthesizing is happening at regular pace. All right? Okay. So that can be turned into a parameter, of course. These are the parameter. Again, this is actually just the repeat of what I just said just now. Dark adapt and light adapt. Dark adapt you in the morning. Light adapt you the rest of the day. Right? So what are the parameters? So these are the parameters. Every FM is you pukul 8 get the job tadi. You receive 80 files from your KJ doesn't mean that you know how to solve all the problem. Just receive because happy, right? So every FM is the maximum quantum yield. Okay. For this plant, it reads 0.84, meaning that from the amount of light particles given, photon given, 84% can be captured. right? For example, this equipment, it knows how much light it will give to the plant. Let's say that it gives 10,000 light units to the leaf. 84% is absorbed, only 60% are released as in the form of fluorescence. That's why it reads 0.84. You get your fluorescence, just 60% of it. Is it a good one? Look at this. Yep, acceptable. Because this is highly conserved. Even you change the species and so on, it's still within that range. Right. And A dark is the estimation during dark, completely darkness. And Q max is how much the flash that you give in order to get this. And for this one, it's about 8,000 micromole. This is a lot. You know 8,000, how bright that is? That tengah hari dekat ladang is about 2,500 micromole. 3 times brighter than ladang pukul 12. I don't know how many layers of sunshade you're going to wear. Super bright, super bright. Okay. So this is dark light, dark adapter, and then light adapter. This is after you have been working for a few hours. So just because you get 84% of light captured doesn't mean that 84% completely going to go to do photochemistry. No. And here comes the second measure. Phi PS2. Phi is the Greek letter, one of the Greek letter, you know, sigma, gamma, epsilon, kappa, and so on. Phi is the universal symbol for efficiency. So when it says here, phi PS2, the efficiency of photosystem 2. The efficiency of what? Not only to absorb light, but to utilize light to do photochemistry. And for this particular plant, it's able to absorb 84% light, and the absorbed light, it can utilize 77% of it to do photochemistry, meaning that this is a very good and behaving plant, right? And the other one, because this is already light, okay, dark, completely no light, light adapted, meaning that the light has been turned on, okay? Phi CO2 is the efficiency of your Kelvin cycle, okay? CO2 here, 0.05%, so it's about 5%, right? ETR is the electron transport rate. Don't worry, all of these got some of them got unit. You can see the unit later. MPQ is the heat release, non-photochemical quenching. And then alternate F0. This is related to this, so I'm not going to explain that. So what can be understood here? So for the beginners, I highly suggest you to focus on two things: FVFM, maximum quantum yield, and Phi PS2, efficient quantum yield. Even if you want to go a bit crazy about it, just go up to Phi CO2. That's it. Because if you go further, now here, you need to join the course next year after I come back from my sabbatical. Okay? Right. So in the LiCOR website, also presented here, these are the parameters related to fluorescence. Okay, there are many. Okay, and this is only fluorescence, okay, not gas exchange. So you got all of these variables of label symbol that you use, and also the description. Okay, so whatever that I've said just now, these are all the description, right? And I've added this as well. What does it mean, and what is the description, and also what is the formula? If you want to understand this column, this formula here, you see Fm minus F0 over Fm, you need to go back a few slides coming to here, because this symbol is universal. F0 is this region here, meaning that Where's my marker? Fluorescence at zero, meaning that all lights off except measuring beam. Measuring beam on. Okay, and then you have your FM. FM is maximum fluorescence. Then you see here FV. V means for variable fluorescence. The difference, the top here minus here, what is the value? That is FV, right? And then you have another kind of F with this prime symbol. Okay, so what's the difference here? You got here FM here versus FM prime. Whenever there is no prime symbol, automatically the convention tells you this is dark adept. Whenever there is a prime symbol here, this is automatically light adept. Okay, this is you 8 a.m. This is you 3 p.m. Okay, right. What about FS? FS, F stands for steady. After the photosynthesis has stabilized for quite some time and then the signals stabilize, that's your FS. Okay, and since there is no prime symbol, usually this doesn't have prime symbol, it's just a right FS. Okay, so coming back to this, and then you have your formula here, FM prime. Can you see here? I'll just give for now, even though I'm not teaching the entire thing. So what you're interested is number one and number what? One and four fluorescence. Can you go a bit more crazy? Yes, you can go CO2, or you can go for number 5 and also number 6. Okay, now I'm being very serious. Just stop. Just stop until you undergo the fluorescent training. Because whatever that you go beyond that, because there are a lot of consideration to be given. Pigments in plants, it can be rather complicated. Right, because you're not talking about one pigment, right? Photo protection. So this is all that you need: electron transport rate, micromole per second. You see, micromole per second. It means the number of electron traveling per second. So can you understand why this instrument is super expensive? Not only that, it can know the number of light photon particles, it can also help you to quantify how many electrons are traveling in the electron transport chain per second for your particular plants. Right? Right. Okay, so this is, you're going to see this later tomorrow. What is the, it looks like with the Excel, okay? Looks rather complicated. Is relax. Okay, all right. Okay, so before we end this, I just want to highlight the interpretation of it. FVFM. Let's create a hypothetical situation. So you have your plant A and plant B. I'll just create this, okay? FVFM here, 0.8, 5, yes, 2, oops, 5, ETR, let's see, what's the reasonable range for that? Oh, ETR, I'm not going to tell us too. Can I see here? Which one is ETR? It's about 17, about 20, 25. plant B, FVFM, Phi PS2, okay. Look at plant A and plant B. Between the two plants, which have the better ability to capture photon energy? Why? All right. Okay, that's good. Remember, FVFM is just the mathematical way of saying it. You masa writing jangan tulis FVFM. Maximum quantum here. You can you use FVFM. If you have mentioned earlier, FVFM is actually quantum year, then you can use it. It's the common convention, not a crime. Right, between plant A and plant B, which one is having better light utilization? Plant B, okay. When yeah, come?
I was wondering, like, you see, light utilization is limited by the PS2, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is it 50% out of 50%
from the new flash given.
Oh.
Yeah. So because 5PS2, the formula is actually independent from this. This is dark, this is light adapted. So if you a bit unsure how the parameter is calculated, you can refer to this table. Look at FVFM. In order to calculate FVFM, FM minus F0 over FM. And this is all from the dark adapt measurements. For the 5PS2, this is the formula. FM prime, you see? Prime. Meaning that this is light adapt minus steady state fluorescence over FM prime again.
Basically, the values at plant A and B with PS2 is directly comparable.
It's comparable. Kalau dia macam ni, just because they have the same value, we still have to look at other parameters. That's why I have the ETR down there, right? So ETR between plant A and plant B, which is having busier electron transport? Plant B. Okay. Between plant A and plant B, who's going to produce more ATP? I was going to use this as my next year exam question, tapi tak pernah tanya sekarang. Tadi kan dah belajar, the product of light reaction ada tiga, kan? Oxygen, ATP, and ADPH. So, between plant A and plant B, siapa paling banyak ATP? Kalau B kenapa? Kalau A kenapa? Okay, who says A will have higher ATP production, energy production? Tak ada. Siapa kata plan B akan ada more ATP? 3, 4, 5, 6. Siapa jawapannya? B lah. B. Sebab sebenarnya ATP tu dia berkait dengan benda ni sebenarnya. Electron transport. There is something that I didn't story tadi sebab sibuk makan ubat kan? ATP. I'll just cover here. Kat sini. Sikit je. Alah. Berkira. Sini. So, the story is, it start from here. Dekat sini kan, you have all the electron acceptor, right? The proteins. So, these proteins, the moment they accept the electron from the reaction center, they will pass the electron from one acceptor to another. Okay, just now I said, we come back, coming back to it. Actually, can the good diagram to use, actually not this diagram, it's actually should be the other slide. Is it in here? Can you open it? Where is it? Ah, this one. Right. Then let's open that. We use the pretty diagram here. Yes, this diagram here. So, how ATP is produced, manufactured? So, tadi dah belajar, the moment the electron get excited, if it doesn't fluoresce, it will proceed with the photochemistry. That means the electron acceptor will accept the electron, and then they will pass from one acceptor to another. One thing interesting happened here actually. You see all these electron acceptor, plus 2 quinone, cytochrome B6F, semua benda ni, they are actually having two faces. Bukan maksud di dalam dua muka. It has the face facing the out into the stroma. Dia ada satu lagi face facing the lumen. Ni susah nak lihat sebab dia tak 3D. Kalau ni sebab dia 2D, kalau 3D senang nampak. So when the electron is passed from one acceptor to another, the side of the electron acceptor, this protein here, plus 2 quinone, dekat luar ni stroma, right? Full of hydrogen ions. Full, memang free. Relax, tak buat apa-apa. So this hydrogen ion suka nak melekat dekat protein. So when it hydrogen ion attaches to the plus 2 quinone, and then there is an electron passing through it, it will scoop the hydrogen from the stroma and then flip it over into the lumen side of it. Meaning that the hydrogen that was once before in the stroma is now in the lumen. So imagine that electron transport, the faster the electron transport happening, can you imagine how much hydrogen going to be cramped in here? You're gonna get a lot. So much so. When there's a lot of hydrogen here and then less hydrogen here, is that ideal? Do you remember osmosis? What's the law of osmosis? It will travel to what to what? High concentration to the low concentration. So the same story applies to hydrogen as well. The moment hydrogen is jammed in this lumen area, it or they want to travel back to the stroma. Unfortunately, they cannot use the same route they come in. No, doesn't work. Except, there is a tunnel here created by this special protein called ATP synthase. You see ATP synthase, if you do the cross-section, it looks like a tunnel. That is one thing. It has this rotor head here. This rotor head can actually spin. In this rotor head, already attached two important things, but they are loosely bound. They are ADP, adenosine diphosphate, and also PI, inorganic phosphate. The moment hydrogen has this urge to travel back to the stroma, it has no choice but to go through this ATP synthase tunnel. The moment it does so, it will turn the rotor head of the ATP synthase and therefore jam together ADP and PI. They are fused together now. When they are fused together, boom, ATP come up. So imagine, when you increase the light intensity, you're going to get lots of excitation here, right? And of course, you're going to get lots of oxygen as well. When you get lots of excitation, of course, your electron transport rate is going to increase from 20, 25, and 30. And when that happens, automatically more and more hydrogen needs to leave the ATP synthesis. And of course, lots and lots of ATP is produced, right? So when I ask that question, it's actually, yeah, that's how it's being answered. But what about if I ask between plant A and plant B, which one is understory plant, the shade plant, tumbuhan tanaman redup, plant A or plant B? You know kan, like house plant tu tanaman redup lah tu. House plant, you go to your office kan, you got, bukan yang plastik, the real one. Which one, plant A or plant B?
A
plant B. So kata A. 4, 6, 7. B, nobody. Dia banyak on the fence. Kenapa tumbuhan A is the shade plant? What is the physiological? Sekarang belajar physiology, right? What was the physiological reason why you make a claim plant A is a shade plant, tanaman redup, not plant B? Okay, in order untuk explain ni, memang kena guna tiga-tiga sekali. Number one, LVFM. It is a law actually, tumbuhan yang dalam tempat redup, because it's so rare to get light, it has to be efficient. The moment, you know, if you go to the jungle, there is a sun dapple. You know dapple? Apa tah? You got the full canopy kan? Tiba-tiba suddenly ada lubang. Lepas tu, you feel like ada apa, light from heaven coming shine through you. So, that sudden light, sometimes happens, sometimes doesn't happen. Right? So, whatever that's growing on the understory vegetation, they need to utilize this moment as efficient as possible. Because it might not come again. So that's why they need the ability to capture light as much as possible. Guna tak guna tu lain cerita, tangkap dulu. Right. And then there comes the 5PS2. This thing, if you compare to this, who is higher?
B.
So nampak tak? And usually the shade plants, they are very effective in capturing photons, but they are slightly not productive in utilizing it because they lack in nitrogen, because dekat bawah they are fragile. Okay, they're not the active type, so there is no need to produce lots of photosystems as compared to the sun plant here. And then when you look at the ETR, 25. This is 30. Just now, you just learned. Low ATR means less intensity of light. So, dekat bawah, high intensity or low intensity? Low intensity. So, that's how you know this is a shade plant. So, that's why it is useful to understand this so that you can make a correct interpretation. Apa lagi yang boleh? Between plant A and plant B, which experience more water stress? You can answer that as well.
Water stress.
Water stress.
Water stress.
Drought.
Which one can you stand?
No, bukan, it's not. Which one is potentially experiencing that spell of drought? A ke B? Who says A?
A.
A. Siapa says? Who says A? Soalan. Atas pagar. Tak ada. One. Oh, kena fikir. Okay. Boleh ambillah masa 2 minit. Okay. Dah. So? Plant A. Okay, siapa cakap A? 3, 4, 5, 6. Siapa cakap B? So, betul ke plant A? Well, no, this is kekurangan air. Dia stress. Dia okay, drought selalu associated apa dengan drought ni? Water kan. Lagi? Suhu drought macam mana selalunya?
Panas.
The apa tu? Air dekat tanah tu senang tak nak ada balik?
Susah.
Susah kan? So pokok tu, is it going to look segar or is it going to crinkle or wilting?
Wilting.
Okay, wilting. So bukan tadi baru belajar ke yang ni dekat understory? Kalau understory, dia kan lebih sejuk. Actually this one, this soalan ni jawab hanya by tengok LVFM sahaja. Because it's not easy to change this, especially for within the same species. The moment this is down, usually kita akan tengok whether it's water stress or insufficient nitrogen. Right. No, it's within the range, but because this is highly conserved, this is still lower than this. This is still lower than that.
So we like simple treatment then text two. So always the same for all the clinic last month. The mode is the same every time. We write it's the same.
Mode tu boleh tukar, tapi dia ada standard yang kita boleh guna setting. It's good for all the plants that we're dealing with. So water stress. Water stress not necessarily tukar 5PS2 and electron transport. Tapi dia bagi stress dekat sini because the membrane sendiri tu ada masalah. Kenapa? Water stress. Selalu daun akan tutup sikit kan? Bila tutup, can it capture in a proper manner? Tak boleh. Yes. Selalu dia stomata apa tutup. Tapi kita tak pergi cerita sebelah sini lah. Kita cerita sebelah sini je baru. Kalau selalu kat sebelah sini, boleh nampak lagi lah. Dia punya kesan tu. Alright. Okay. Boleh. Apa lagi nak boleh interpret? Risau tak kalau go my class? My soalan kan, I can confirm you. No ChatGPT, Gemini, Copilot, semua kau tanya dia tak jawab. It has been designed in such a way. Google, Yahoo, Bing, no, of no help. Dia jadi macam apa ayat Quran kata, apa ibu saudara semua tidak menjadi guna lagi membantu, hanya amalan baikmu sahaja. And in this case, your revision. Right, okay. What about if I spray the DCMU, the herbicide? Do you know DCMU? Alright, okay. Which plant do you think is experiencing the herbicide effect?
A.
A or B?
A.
A. Why?
ETR.
Yes. Yeah. It's cut down the ETR transport. If I'm interested to know whether within these two plants who is having sufficient phosphate, which plant you think having sufficient phosphate? A or B?
B.
Why? Yes, ATP production cycle. Ha, boleh lah. Yes. Yeah. Sebab fosfat digunakan untuk pembentukan ADP, adenosine diphosphate tu, and juga PI, inorganic phosphate yang larut dalam sup stroma tu. Tak, herbicide ada banyak mode of action. Yeah, ada banyak mode of action. Actually, banyak herbicide trigger pembuka stomata, otherwise dia tak boleh masuk dalam. Banyak-banyak herbicide dia masukkan other additive to dia dua benda. Satu, dia open the stomata. Satu lagi, dia loosekan cuticle crack. You know dekat permukaan daun ada cuticle, right? Sebenarnya cuticle tu ada crack. So dia tambah some kind of additive so that adjuvant lah, senang cakap adjuvant, so that the penetration to become better. Right. Okay. Right. Okay. So tu je lah. Apa lagi? Alright. What time now? Alright. Tak apalah, hari first, relax, relax. Kan? Buka problem ni. Okay. I think that's all for the quick introduction for the fluorescence. Okay? So, for you, we just demo once and then you do for yourself sebab tak ramai kan? How to adapt the plant. Okay? So, adapt for the plant ni, ada... Sebab it's not about chlorophyll fluorescence, right? You need to adapt. Kan dia tulis tadi, adapt ni? No, no. So, macam mana nak adapt? Yeah. Ah, bukan dengan plastik, dengan ni, apa ni? Aluminium foil. Ke datang sini untuk tengok? Ke tak nampak? Korang nampak? Okay. Tak apa macam ni, datang sekejap kat sini untuk tengok, nanti boleh buat sendiri. Masing-masing. Label lah, ambil marker, label your own name. Okay. Dekat sini, we have two plants, two leaf morphology. We have the linear type and then the rounded or ellipse type. Right? So this is grass. Pokok, apa ni? Bukan rumput. Jagung. Okay. Leaf selection is very important, not only for fluorescence but for photosynthesis measurement as well. Untuk tumbuhan dari keluarga rumput, the way you select the plant is by and not by counting. You need to understand the anatomy of the leaf. Okay, it has to be leaf that has been fully expanded, not mature. No, not that's not the word. Fully expanded. There is a visible cue that you can use to know whether the leaf is fully expanded or not. So, based on here, I'll just take the one in here. Okay. So this is one unit of leaf. Okay. This is called leaf sheath, seludang daun. This is called leaf blade, or lie down, the lamina of the leaf. The way you can know whether this leaf has fully expanded or otherwise is by looking whether there is a presence of collar. It's a collar here. Oh. Collar. Look at this guy. There's a collar there. Okay. Can see there's a collar there. Meaning that starting from this leaf you can use, but what about this leaf? Any collar? No. What about this leaf? Belum lagi. The leaf sheath is still expanding. Dia tak unroll habis lagi. Jadi, ini tak boleh. Ini tak boleh. Ini dah boleh belum? Boleh. Bolehlah sikit. Sikitlah boleh. Tapi kalau tak confident, go one level lower. Use this. So, ini dah boleh. Ini dah boleh. Maksudnya, this is your best bet. If you go any longer, takut dia dah senesing, tengok ni. Lembik aja, kan? Ni dah pukul 8 dah malam dah ni. Ha, kalau macam ni. Okay. So let's say that I want to use this leaf. The good practice is to know what is the midsection for this leaf. This leaf is called lanceolate. Right? Dia bentuk macam, apa tu? Pedang. Pedang, right? So, go for the middle. Selalunya leaf macam ni, dia banyak. Banyak macam ni. Boleh guna. Tapi untuk simplicity, we go for the middle here. The middle of the middle. Right. This section. So, this is the part that you cover with the aluminum foil. To the adapt, yeah. Kelapa sawit? Sama je. Sama. The middle, that's why I said the middle of the middle. Satu ada front. Go to the middle of the front and then go to the middle of individual leaflet. Middle of the middle. Right. Sebab sebenarnya satu pelepah kelapa sawit itu adalah satu daun. Tapi evolusi disebabkan pokok tu selalu hilir tepi pantai angin kuat. So it has decided to evolve to split so that the wind can pass through. So that's why you get the leaflet. So kalau front tu panjang ni, go with the middle and then choose salah satu kiri kanan and then choose the middle of it. Right. Okay. How much area you need to cover? Actually, kalau boleh biar sepanjang-panjang diameter bulatan gasket. Ini sekitar 2.7 macam tu cm. Right. So kalau boleh biar cover masuk dalam lah. Okay. Senang saja. Macam ni kan. Aku tahu buat keripap. Tak perlu banyak-banyak sebab nanti berat pokok tu tumbang. Ha. Mesti kau dye, pergi dye rambut kan? Kadang-kadang orang tu tak cerita macam tu. Ha, ni berlebih ni sebenarnya. Yelah tu. Okay. So katalah this is the region that you interested with. Ni ada dua belah tau. Satu kilat dan satu tak kilat. Bukan kilat petir tu. Ni. Ambil belah yang macam cermin tu, dihadapkan keluar. Yang belah nampak macam matte tu, masuk belah dalam. Sebab ni reflect. Sebab kita tak nak bagi cahaya. Ya, kita nak reflect the cahaya. Okay, lepas tu pelan-pelan balut je lah. Balut je. Balut je. Lepas tu kalau nak confident lagi, ambil tape ke ataupun klip kertas untuk klip dia. Ah, ni ada. Ni berat ni besi. Nah, jangan guna sepit rambut. Ni. Selalunya kan kalau dah clip elok, dia selalunya okey je. Okey. Okey, lepas tu ambil marker kalau nak buat labeling kat bawah supaya tahu. Okey. Ini boleh buat untuk setiap orang kejap lagi. Supaya semua orang boleh ambil AVFM besok lah. You get the experience hands on. Okey. Letak label nama nanti berebut. Okey, ini untuk ada lagi kat luar. Ada lagi. Tanya manager. Mana manager? Tu Encik Aizan, manager tu tanaman. Ada lagi. Ini demo. Demo. Ni aja kena kongsi. Okey, ini dipanggil sebagai rounded leaf or ellipse leaf. Okey. Mana satu nak guna? Mana satu nak guna? Nombor satu selalunya kita pergi the main trunk. Tapi kalau pokok tu highly bushy macam ni, caranya adalah kena kuat-kuat dia sikit. Kan? Pergi kuat-kuat dia sikit. Nampak tak bila dia start jadi Y tu? Ni, sini. Use your finger naik atas sampai dia start to stop. Situ boleh. Ni. Either belah kanan or belah kiri. Maksudnya kalau dia tiba-tiba dekat tepi-tepi, jangan gunalah. Kita guna yang ni. So lepas tu naik lagi sampai ke atas. Sampai kat hujung. So nak guna benda ni. Tapi sebenarnya ini sebenarnya dah kurang elok sebab dia dah ada buah-buahan. Jadi the sink organ ni dah ambil semua nutrien daun ni. Sosiensisnya kan. Jadi cuba elak branch yang ada buah-buahan tempatan ni. Pergi yang belah yang tak berapa nak ada sangat. Pusing. Kita kawal dia kan. Macam ni. Ni ada sos cili Maggi. Tak ada. So kita guna yang ni. So macam mana? Rule-nya adalah untuk tumbuhan macam ni, 3 to 5 fully expanded from the top. Leaf tau. Okay. Ini kena dibetulkan. Ini bukan leaf. Ni primordia lagi ni. Primordia lagi. Kecil-kecil ni. Kecil-kecil ni lagi. Jangan guna lagi. Ini dah boleh guna leaf. Tapi kita takkan nak guna benda tu. So kita ambil level dia. Level 1 tak boleh guna. Level 2 bawah ni pun macam kecil lagi. So go lagi satu level. Ni. Ni tingkat 1. Ni tingkat 2. Bawah satu tingkat 3. So nak tahu nombor 3 boleh guna ke tak, compare dengan yang nombor 4 bawah. Kalau nampaknya lebih kurang, guna je lah. Boleh guna lah. Sama je. So This one dah boleh. Kenapa tak nak guna bawah lagi? Takut dia dah senesing.
Dia dah
usut. Ya, ya. Ya. So kaedah dia sama. Boleh tolong potong. Siapa pandai buat baju? Dia macam ni, untuk statistical reason minimum is 3. Ya. Kalau daun tu besar sangat macam daun pokok pisang, you can take 3 tu daripada daun pelepah yang sama tu, tapi lokasi berlainan. Tapi sebenarnya tu tak digalakkan. Yang terbaiknya satu reading from satu line. Lepas tu move kepada yang lain. Baru sample representation tu ni. Sebab statistik dia ada tu kan, random sampling punya tu. Pokok pokok pisang tu sebab tu kata kalau dia memang besar dan memang kita nak tahu the top region, the middle region, the bottom region, gunakanlah satu yang sama tu. Sebab dia besar, kan? Besar, tapi pisang boleh buat sampan. Ya, ya.
Kenapa nak ambil yang akal?
Oh, sebab this is the main trunk. The main trunk selalunya urat dia paling besar. Jadi fotosintesis daun yang dalam main trunk tu selalunya paling.
Yang
hujung. Paling hujung. Jangan masuk dalam sebab dalam ni dah redup. Bila redup, fotosintesis sudah greatly reduced. Jadi ambil yang paling hujung.
Paling terdedah.
Paling terdedah, exposed to light. Ingat ya, paling terdedah bukan paling tinggi. I didn't say paling tinggi. Kan? Orang kata orang paling kaya, tak paling kaya, tak boleh kepala bijak. Kan? Dah kaya, tak cantik pula. So kalau nak ambil ni, boleh ke? Cuma cili ni, ni adalah example ni. Dia senang kena virus. Kalau ada virus, janganlah. Pergi belah lain. So boleh kira, jangan kira yang ada virus tu. Kira yang ni, satu. Dah daun. Dua, bawah lagi satu. Lepas tu, lagi satu. Ada lagi tak? Ke tak ada dah habis? Ni tiga. Ni boleh guna dah. So let's say tadi kita nak guna mana dah lupa dah ini. Kata nak guna, guna yang ni. Kan, ambil ni. Ini pun macam ada basah-basah. Seelok-eloknya ambil tisu untuk di padded-kan sikit. Ada tisu? Sebab ini adalah gas exchange measurement, bukan liquid measurement. Kalau liquid, sekejap je nyawa dia. Tak payah ni sangat, sikit-sikit je. Okay. Alright. So dah ambil tu, boleh tutup terus. Berapa lama nak dah adapt ni? Kalau ikut buku teks, dia kata 20 minit dah cukup, tapi itu tipu. Jangan percaya. Betul, buku teks ni kan banyak ada masalah sebenarnya. Seelok-eloknya overnight, tapi kalau tak boleh tunggu 4 jam, dah okey dah. Ni nak clip, dah boleh clip. Betul label. Dah. Tadi reaction center ni, mana was ni? Ni. Reaction center tu akan mula terbuka semuanya. Mana kata tadi? Ni. Kalau kita tak ada adapt, dia akan jadi macam ni. Tapi bila kita dah adapt, dia akan ada lubang. Lubang ni ready untuk terima apa-apa cahaya yang diberikan. Tutup je lah, tutup.
Kalau daun panjang bolehlah.
Ya, contohnya daun kelapa sawit tadi tu ataupun daun ni, nampak ni. Tak payahlah tutup semua. Nanti pokok tu bangkit kata, kenapa? Tak payah. Sebab dalam alam tumbuhan ni, morfologi daun tu macam-macam kan? Ada, nanti tengok, pagi esok kita guna pokok ubi. Ubi tu jari lima. Mana satu kau nak guna? Kata, saya suka kelingking. Tak ada. Right.
Masa nak ambil,
seelok-eloknya pagilah. Pagi, sebabnya waktu tu memang pokok tu dia tengah engkau pukul 8. Kan? Tengah hari tak, kita takut macam ni. Kalau ambil tengah hari kan, buka aja terus pokok tu yang belah kanan. Kalau kita ambil pagi kan redup lagi kan. Tapi kalau tak boleh nak elakkan, pakai payung. Betul, pakai payung. Kalau tak boleh nak elakkan, tapi saya pukul 11 baru boleh, pukul pagi meeting. Apa SO. Pakai payung. Masa buat ni, ya. Pakai payung.
Okey.
Sebab kita tak nak light tu mengganggu menjadi condition yang sebelah kanan. Kita nak dia kekal condition belah kiri itu. Open reaction center. Reaction center takkan open selagi daun ni tak relax dan elektron flush out of the system. Ni nak flush out elektron ni daripada sistem. Completely empty.
Tu kalau dia dari 4 jam sebelum, at least
tu kalau dah sempat sangat lah. Macam kau apa jenis tak nak beringat awal. Kan aku dah kata buat awal tapi degil. Tapi kalau nak buat, kata nak buat pukul 8-9 pagi esok, sebelum balik kerja, engkau selunkanlah pokok ni. Boleh ke? Tak apa. Dia okey je. Sebab dia pun dah nak malam dah. Alright. Okay. So, any question? Kalau tak ada question, siapa yang rasa kena nak ambil measurement esok, buat. Ada dua tu. Ada apa tu? Con dengan ni. Ambil. Buat. Tulislah nama. Ada marker tak bagi? Bagi marker yang permanent. So that. Ada. Ni. Ni ah. Ini untuk group ni. Buat both untuk ni. Ini boleh kongsi ramai, boleh kongsi tiga. Buat. Ni lagi. Ya. Buatlah. sebab FVFM tu sekejap aja. FVFM buat sekejap aja. Dia terus dapat. Tak payah besar-besar sangat. Boleh lah besar, takut pokok teroboh.
Bisa nak buat apa?
Balut daun aja. Cili jangan petik. Dia balut satu ladang. Ambil memang untuk kumpulan ni. Tak, yang kedua, jadi esok boleh tengok FVFM untuk tumbuhan grass dan juga untuk tumbuhan dicot. Ini monocot.
Oh.
Ini monocot. Ini monocot. Monocotyledonous plant. Dicotyledonous plant.
Dia ada satu dicot. Dia ada satu cotyledon saja. Ha. Yang ini tak buat.
Ya. Ini tak acil lah ni. Ini buka balik.
Guna lain boleh.
Ataupun kalau tak boleh berpisah dengan kawan, gunalah dua sebelah-sebelah. See, pairing.
Is it the same with the flowering plants?
Try to avoid yang memang flower dah blooms heavily because much of the
but still okay.
Yeah, this janganlah, memang all the photosynthesis has been transferred to the growing fruit kan. Hello, dah balut nah.
Doktor Nazmin, yang ni boleh guna expanding tip kan?
Boleh?
Nombor 2,
nombor 3. Tu, apa, melastoma? Boleh. Guna ni, apa ni? Kami yang baru sebab dah kenyok lah tu. Okay, dah nak pukul 4. Kalau dah sudah boleh balik ni untuk kita wrap up for today. Ni siapa punya? Ni?
Ni yang benda ni.
Oh, alright. Okay. Right. Okay. Pulang ke jalan yang lurus. Okay, bertenang. Selalu kalau ada apa student dalam kelas, marah aja kan. Ni takkan nak marah kan. Nanti traumatic event PTSD pula. Tak datang dah fisiologi. Okay, so quiz tu boleh buat balik rumah kan. You want to pray ancestor to come to help tonight, then so be it. Senang kan? My soalan very senang. Okay, so I think that's all for today, and we wrap up our fluorescence session for now. Ada soalan? Any question about fluorescence or any other lessons before this? The foundation for plant requirements and photosynthesis. Ada soalan? Okay, all good? All good? Okay. So, so kita, yeah, soalan. Apa nak tayang jam kat aku? Aku pun ada lah. Habis dah tak ada soalan lah macam mana. Okay, so esok datang, kita, before kita mula the measurement, kita recap quickly. And then we'll see how to do, let's get introduced to the equipment first untuk esok. So kita follow macam dalam tentative tu. Because you need to understand machine ni, dia ada parts dia, right? And when it came from the back, dia tak macam ni. You need to build sebenarnya. So esok belajar nak pasang dia. Belajar pasang dia sampai dia boleh berfungsi untuk berjalan dan ambil data. Right? Okay? Okay, alright. Happy? Happy? Ada bangkangan? Boleh, you don't, I'm okay. Bukannya apa, North Korea kan dictator. Okay, so kalau tak ada dah, kita boleh dismiss class lah. I'll see you tomorrow. Okay, alright, terima kasih.